Hi, Jeff Burke here from Broadband Forum. We're here in Warsaw, Poland at our Q1 meeting. And I'm here today with Dave Sinicrope. Dave, not only are you a longstanding director on the board, but you also are the director of the work area that is access and transport architectures. Correct?
Yes, we that was great. We just named it, so you did well getting that new name down.
I had to practice my tongue twisters. All right. So at any rate, what I want to chat with you about today is 5G transport. I know that there's been a lot of movement in that area over the course of the last, you know, I wouldn't want to say couple of quarters, but it's really been in the last couple of months.
Yes.
Every conference I go to, 5G is at the top of the top of mind for everyone, and how networks are going to handle really gracefully this the reality that 5G is actually going to become a reality here in the next over the course of the next year or so, moving from trials into real deployments. So what's going on in the Broadband Forum in terms of thinking about and preparing for this?
So we've got a work area specifically on 5G transport. I think the last time I talked to you, we had talked about the scale of 5G and how to handle the exabytes of data that it was going to bring. We need to scale up the transport network. What we're dealing with now is getting more into detail about how we're going to do that. So we've actually got the 3GPP architecture, the new 5G architecture, with that they call it the low layer split. And we're working on, you know, from years past in LTE, it's like all about getting the data for backhaul, right? So from the base station back to the mobile core network. With 5G, the way the architecture is split up, I now have to get data from the antenna to something that's called the distributed unit. And then there's more data that goes from the distributed unit to something they call the central unit. And then we hit our good old friend, the backhaul interface that goes all the way back to the core network. Although it's in a kind of a backhaul network on steroids, because it really has to handle things like exabytes worth of data, you know, all the way back in.
Right.
Plus that centralized unit. So the distributed unit and the centralized unit form what used to be the base station, and actually the antenna too, except the antenna was at the top of the mast. That centralized unit is also being virtualized, right? So now I even have some data center aspects to work into the architecture. Anyway, this is all very interesting, and we've got a good piece of work going on now. We call it WT521, previously known as WT5G transport. And this is where we've laid out that 3GPP architecture, and we've superimposed it over the traditional transport network architecture that shows access aggregation core. And what we're working out now is, what are the characteristics that are necessary to support that 5G network, and then what transport will I put into place to do that support?
Well, it's funny because I get the sense that through a lot of the recent activities, right, that have some of the work in getting ready for the handoffs for 3GPP, right, and even in some of the work that now, as we know that 5G is going to become a reality in the short-term future here, that we're really down to crossing T's and dotting I's now, and the details of how this is ultimately going to play out.
Right, exactly. And also, in addition to getting down to the details, so where am I going to use time division multiplexing, optical networking? Where am I going to use IPMPLS networking? And then there's developments even going on right now in IEEE and IETF that we're partnered up on. One is in IEEE is called time-sensitive networking, and the one in the IETF is called deterministic networking. And these are new technologies that make the packet transport network even more predictable and reliable. And these are the types of things that we will need for the 5G services. So we're actually getting into pointing not just at, you know, we should use Ethernet here. No, we need this piece, you know, we need this Ethernet with the following specs for OAM, and we're going to, for time-sensitive networking, we're going to point to those specs. So we really are getting into what looks like a standardized RFP. is essentially what will end up this thing end up looking like.
Interesting.
So
well, so let's think about this. So you basically got through this quarter's meeting, right?
Yes.
As you look forward, barely.
Yes, barely.
So as you look forward through the next couple of quarters, what can we expect? Do you think coming out of your team and your work area?
Okay, so out of the work area, this is 5G transport was one of many things, but on the 5G transport front, what we'll start seeing is two things. One, there'll be a lot more contribution and progress of the details and a lot more interaction with IEEE, IETF, ITU Study Group 15. In addition, we'll start coming out with market reports. So letting people know what we're doing, how we're doing it, the approach that we're taking, so that they can kind of follow the journey with us and stay tuned to what we're producing.
And this really almost comes to a head as we get closer and closer to the end of the year, as some of these early technology trials now turn into the realities of the foundations of mass deployment, right?
Absolutely. The trial started last year. We had the Seoul Olympics. Mm-hmm. Now we're going into even more trials, and people are finding new ways to use the technology. So things will just get more interesting.
You're
right here.
Keep getting busier and busier, I think, as the year progresses. Well, Dave, thank you very much for your leadership on this. I know this, as I mentioned, it's been a hot topic everywhere we've been over the course of the last couple of months and quarters, and it's just going to accelerate as we go through 2019. So looking forward to it.
Me too.
All right. Thanks, Jeff. This is Jeff Burke and Dave Sinicrope signing off from Warsaw.